Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello and welcome to Wednesday, which in these parts is TV Guidance Counselor Day. I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, and it is time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor, and it's a supersized edition with two guests today. We have a married couple, Mr. Paul Dini and Misty Lee. Not our first married couple that we've had on the show, I don't think. No, we've had couples, but this is the first married couple. Interesting. Anyway. Very, very good. I'm a huge fan of both of them. They're both incredible artists, do some amazing stuff. Paul is a writer. You may know him best from the DC Animated Universe stuff that he's worked on, Batman the Animated Series, Justice League, which if you're a regular listener of the show, you know is my favorite comic adaptation of all time. Misty is a magician, a mentalist. She is the resident seance, I don't know what the word would be, seance person, at the Magic Castle. She is incredibly talented, really, really great. She is also a voiceover actress, does a ton of stuff, and it was great to have both of them on at the same time because they are both incredible guests in their own right, doubled them together. Even better. So I was very happy to talk to them. In fact, we barely got through the week. So if you're just listening to the podcast for the first time because you're a fan of Paul and Misty's, the concept of the show is that I own every issue of TV Guide. Someone picks an old edition of TV Guide. They sit down, they go through it, they write down what they'd watch that week, and then we discuss their choices. Paul and Misty did that. We only got to about Monday night, so I've been promised that we will do a part two. This is, as I say at the end here, our first cliffhanger episode, but we had a lot of great tangents, a lot of great conversation. They're both super smart, fascinating people. Love talking to them, and you will love hearing me talk to them. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor, which I think will be a part one, part two to follow at some point in the future, undetermined, with Paul Dini and Misty Lee.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me.
And my guests, plural today, are Misty Lee and Paul Dini. How are you guys?
We're awesome. Great. How are you?
Very good. Thank you guys so much for trekking up to the borrowed homestead.
Thank you for taking us on a nostalgic journey so we can watch TV together.
You're quite welcome. There's been some fun flipping. We picked a 1985 fall preview edition. Mm-hmm. Although less haggling than I thought. It was a pretty quick decision for two people. And I always joke that... What's that thing that married couples go to? Like, I think it might just be a Catholic thing, but they have to like meet with a priest and like talk about their. I always think they should just do this, like have to go through a TV guide together and then like be mediation. Like, okay, yeah, this is fine.
Yeah.
This is the test.
We don't meet with a priest. Occasionally, magicians or sorcerers or something like that.
Similar.
You're getting mentorship from currently.
Sorry. Yeah, he's talking about in crisis though, like from mediation.
Well, I think it's before. It's like before you get married.
Oh, like the counseling.
That's what it is. Yeah. I don't even know if they do that still.
Either. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if anyone even still does that, but that's always what
you
I think
have
of.
To.
Do you really?
In order to get married, I think in the Catholic Church, you have to be approved by the parish.
Oh, geez.
Otherwise, they will not sanction your marriage.
It's like a verbal blood test.
Why do you want to get married? It is.
Yeah.
It's like, why do you want to get married? How do you
is it for the right
be,
things?
Are you able to put the Lord first?
Wow.
All that stuff that they ask.
Growing up, it was all Catholic all the time. And my mother was Episcopalian. And then they moved away from the small town where there's a Catholic church in San Francisco. There was an Episcopalian church. My dad said, hey, I like this better. So, hey, we're Episcopalian now.
So you didn't have to do the counseling
nothing,
before.
Nothing. It's just
we got married by Alex Ross's dad in a wine cellar.
And who is not a priest.
Oh, he is.
Yeah.
He is in Kingdom Come.
Oh, wow.
No, he's a preacher.
He's a proper reverend.
Okay.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah,
that's good. Because we got married. A comedian got ordained online. And, and he did our marriage in exchange for a bottle of Maker's Mark.
Nice.
Very good. Yeah,
I've done a couple weddings for about the same. I got that $30 Universal Life Church thing.
Yep.
Also got a $30 Doctor of the Universe certificate.
Excellent.
And a Doctor of Metaphysics. I would appreciate you both calling me Doc.
Nice. You have a really big business card that has a series of letters after.
I will pose as a moil for a bottle of Blanton's.
That's fine.
Guy will do it for Maker's Mark, I'll go in with a knife for a bottle of Blanton's.
As long as you get the bottle after you've done the bris. We don't want you to down that before.
I'm just going
to
take it and run.
But you get to keep the tip.
That's true. Oh.
Yeah. We are firing on
Yeah, that's a nice, yeah, that's a good thing about being a moil. Nice tips.
Oh, I'm sure some comic has that joke. Like, I just do it for the tips. I don't have to claim them on taxes.
Yeah.
Oh,
God.
Oh, my. Anyway, on to.
I just do it for the tips.
Just for the tips. Boom. If we can find a 70-year-old Jewish comic, we could just be his writing staff now today.
It's Los Angeles. Throw a rock.
We can make all that.
Throw a rock.
Yeah.
I do anyway. Yeah. No.
Oh, God.
We could be making that sweet, sweet summer stock money.
That's right. There we go.
So you ended up picking an 85, and you were already out here working in TV at that time.
Well, I was in California working, but I was actually working up in San Francisco for George Lucas on the Eworks and Droids Show, which premiered that week.
Yeah, it was,
and I'm looking
in the TV guide.
And I'm looking there as a picture of, oh, there's Princess Knisa. Oh, look at that. I haven't seen her in about 40 years. Okay.
Was that the first thing that you worked on that aired?
No, I had been jobbing around Los Angeles for a few years prior to that, and I think I worked on Masters of the Universe.
Yes,
developing
so in
82 that.
Or 83?
Yeah, and Pat Albert and the Cosby Kids, and a few things like that. I'd worked at a studio called Filmation, and then I'd done some freelancing. Lou Scheimer, how are you? Lou Scheimer's a great guy in animation. He was old. Kind of shifty godfather of animation. And here's a funny story.
The Fat Albert story.
I was on a movie set talking to Chris Rock one day, and he said, Bill Cosby did, we're talking cartoons. He goes, Bill Cosby did all the voices on that show. And I said, yeah, he did a lot of them. And he goes, and Chris said, and they got all these black kids in to do the voices. And I said, no, that's not true. And he goes, what? And I said, well, as soon as Cosby was done and they got Cosby out of the building, because he only showed up like twice a year to record the voices, Lou Scheimer would sit down and he'd do all the voices.
Oh, yeah.
Or something. All right, cue me up. Who am I doing? Dumb Donald? Hey, Fat Albert, let's go down the swimming hole. And then he'd do all the voices, and then his kids would come in and do the rest of the voices. And Rock looks at me like,
You've ruined my childhood.
You've assassinated Santa Claus in front of me. How dare you? But no, Luke was a good guy for saving a buck.
You did a ton of, that's when Chris Rock was just like, wait a minute, Dumb Donald was Orko.
Yeah, that's right.
Totally.
Lou Scheimer did all the, what we call the nyeah characters. They'd always have the little nyeah guy.
The Frank Welker role.
Gee hee, man, I'm sorry. I just want to help. I'm a little screw up.
It'd be funny if he started an animation studio just because that was his dream. Like, someday I want to just voice these kind of characters, and I have to start a studio just to do it. So I was going to say, if that was the first show that made it to TV Guide as this is premiering, at that time, I don't know if you're at the supermarket and you see the show you're working on as in the front cover.
Oh, I saw the TV Guide, and I realized, I've got this in a box somewhere. I think I did save it, because I was working up in San Francisco in Marin County, and my parents lived in the East Bay in Orinda. So, I must have trooped over there that Saturday morning to watch it with them and everything, because then it was sort of a novelty, so my brothers and sister would watch it with us, and it was kind of fun. And then working over at Skywalker Ranch was tremendous, because it's the sort of idyllic little enchanted fairy village off in the middle of the hills. It was beautiful up there.
Far enough away from LA that it's not deep ingrained in the thing, but you're still working in that world, so that must have been exciting. And you were still in Detroit at that time, because you grew up there. Okay. Yeah.
She was going this show with the Ewoks is total crap. What's Punky Brewster doing?
Yeah, we're probably around the same age. Well, Punky Brewster had a cartoon that season too.
Yeah, she did.
Which was real bizarre.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that did have all the kids from Punky Brewster did the voices.
Yeah.
I have a theory about that show, which you may or may not be able to dispel being on the other side.
Did you write on it?
No.
My theory is that someone pitched that show as an unrelated to Punky Brewster show. Like a little girl gets a magical elf named Glomer, and they're like, that's boring. And then the guy was just like, and she's Punky Brewster, and they're like, sold. Now we're in, because it has nothing to do with anything.
Well, that's how, getting back to Lou Scheimer, that's exactly how he sold shows. He would get something licensed. Okay, we got the Brady Bunch kids. Okay, we got to have the Brady Bunch kids. Okay, now I got a dog, and we can reuse the animation from Hot Dog from Archie as the dog. And I have this show about pandas. It didn't sell, but we'll put the pandas in there. And I have this idea about a magical bird. So we'll put the bird in there, and then the Brady kids will sell. And then the bird will spin off into its own show, and the pandas will get their own show. And that's the way they used to lump them all together. All the producers used to do that. And in fact, Joe Barbera once went into NBC, and he had a bunch of ideas to pitch them. And one was about female cops in the future, like a Jetson, a buddy. space cops in the future and they're girls. And then he had the rights to Casper the Friendly Ghost. And then he had the rights to, something else. And then he comes out of the meeting and he pitched these three ideas. And then he calls his partner, Bill Hanna, and he says, well, I sold the show. And Bill says, great, which show? He goes, all of them in the same half hour. So they lumped this show with
Josie and the Pussycats, I think.
Because they went to space.
Well, it was a space show. And then it was the female cop show. And then it was the Casper the Friendly Ghost show. And then it was like, Casper is in the future with two female cops.
Angie Dickinson's dead.
And
she's in the future.
And then
Ann Jillian.
Yes,
remember?
It's Ann Jillian. Yes. That. Oh, Jennifer.
And then
the sexy actress ghost in your house, Jennifer Slepian. Yeah.
I love Casper, but if he could be a sexy vampy actress,
yeah.
With an Uncle Stinky.
Margaret Lesh told me the story, and she was head of Fox Kids for a long time, and she worked with Bill and Joe over at Hanna-Barbera. And she said, and after Bill said they were doing all three series mashed into one, there was silence on the phone, and Bill Hanna just said, "Well, at least we're keeping everybody working through Christmas."
But yeah.
And that was their work ethic from, you know, old guys who started in the 20s and 30s in animation is like, we got to keep going. We got to keep the doors open. We got to keep people working. And it was more like, yeah, we're not doing Tom and Jerry in its heyday anymore. We're not even doing Huckleberry Hound. We're just doing, we're keeping people busy.
Yeah,
we're keeping the lights on.
If we can make something great, it's despite all that, not because of it.
So yeah.
It was, I always say that cartoons always got weird, or you could tell they were running out of ideas when they'd be in a band or go to space.
Yeah. Babies.
That seemed to be, yes,
babies.
And
yes.
Then babies. Babies. Yeah. Babies.
Which was, I think, post Muppet Babies. That was,
yeah. Well, Muppet Babies was cute.
Muppet Babies is amazing, but I think the guys were like, wait a minute, there's a third option behind band and space. They could be babies now. We didn't even think of that.
See, I hate Muppet Babies.
I love it.
Well, see, that's a, maybe it's
well,
a generational.
We were really
generational,
little, yeah.
The thing is, I think the thing was, like, I grew up on the very first generation of Muppets when they were these creepy, weird, scary things on the
Saturday
Ed Sullivan.
Night Live and Ed
yeah. Sullivan. And then when I saw them doing them in animation and where they walked real slow and they moved just like every other kind of badly animated character at the time, I thought, you robbed them of what made them unique, which is these tactile creations.
Yeah, it was that uncanny nature, of, like automatons or something.
Right.
Like, yeah.
Well, like the first time, I remember on the Muppet Show, the first time I saw Beaker, for instance, you had Dr. Honey doing, my assistant Beaker comes in, he's got these popped out eyes. And
yeah, like, his mouth is like a really weird trap door.
He comes in and you know he's just going to get slaughtered. And I was laughing already. And when you see a drawing of him, it just doesn't work.
Yeah,
it didn't work to me in the same way.
Because the puppeteers were able to imbue a very special personality.
Exactly.
To translate into. Yeah. I get that. But in Muppet Babies, it didn't matter because it was, we already knew their personalities from the Muppet Show.
Yeah.
So it was a mini version of what we had already seen.
Although
so
I do have,
yeah, sure.
I do have a childhood trauma I refer to as the Skeeter conundrum.
Oh.
Oh.
And as a kid, I didn't know that Muppet Babies was produced after the Muppets, and chronologically obviously takes place before.
Sure.
Yeah.
Skeeter,
yeah.
Introduced as Scooter's sister on the Muppet Babies, not in the Muppet Show.
True.
No one ever talks about her. What the hell happened to Skeeter?
Well, you know, people are debating that now. There's a lot of discussion online now that the Muppets have their own weekly show. Like, are we ever going to see Skeeter?
Yeah.
Because we hear creepy things about Scooter's home life.
Like, oh, are they actually writing that into the show now?
Well, from what we can discern, Scooter lives at home with his mom.
Okay.
And she is seeing a guy named Ken, who he talks about.
Not me.
Very derisively. And it's like, he'll say odd things like, put your robe on you when you walk around the house, Ken. And everybody kind of looks at him. So there's something weird there.
Yeah.
So maybe Skeeter ran away when Ken showed up.
Changed her name or something.
We don't know.
But the thing, the Muppet Babies did a thing where, one of the things I loved about the Muppet Show was that it taught us about the whole history of show business in
right,
a weird way.
Yeah.
And there's all these vaudeville things and stuff that as a kid you would never encounter. And the Muppet Babies kind of did that as well for younger generations where they're showing clips from old movies and making Casablanca references and Twilight Zone references and stuff that, you know, toddlers aren't getting now and things. But, you know, the same way the Looney Tunes did.
Yeah.
You're getting an education about show business, whether you like it or not, like Mad Magazine used to do, and just in a slightly different format, I think.
Well, I will hand it to Muppet Babies for that, is that they were not afraid to embrace classical things that were classic at that time, like the late 80s. And sort of pay homage to that and do jokes about that. Whereas in cartoons now, you know, it's almost like they hold up a cross to, oh, stay away from that. No, don't
it's
talk
five
about
5 years old.
Don't talk about anything that a kid wouldn't have seen last year because that's already old. You
and then they're working up a new origin if it's over 5 years old. Yeah. Like, oh, we got to revamp Spider-Man.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the weird thing. Not to get too into like comic superhero talk. We'll jump to the TV in a second. But sure. I don't understand the constant origin for these characters that everybody, like if everybody knows, you could go to a country where they don't even, they've never seen a television.
Yeah.
And you're like Superman and they're like, oh yeah, he's an alien.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And super, and you're like, we don't need to show this again.
Batman, parent shot in an alley.
Yeah.
He took it bad way and became a crime fighter.
The thing I always say is if you go see a romantic comedy and you know the lead character's a bellboy, nobody's like, I really want to know how he got that job. Like, could we show him interviewing for the job and being hired for the job?
We
because
see him doing it.
If I don't know how he got that job, I don't, him having this interaction with this woman makes no sense to me.
I think a lot of times, isn't it true that it's you helping the executive understand where this came from? Like the executive says, I don't know anything about Spider-Man, so I need you guys to tell me because people don't know. And what they mean by people don't know is I don't know Spider-Man.
Yeah. I'm people, so you need to get
and,
me
and so
and that's
a lot
the person
of,
that signed your check. So.
Yeah, and that is the thing is like if you get a producer who is very conversant in geek culture and knows the origins of these characters and everything, like a J.J. Abrams, or when I worked on Lost, Damon Lindelof, and I could speak the geek, you know, Brian K. Vaughan and Javier Grillo, Mark Swatch, we all worked on that show at various times. And Brian Burke. We all speak the geek, and we all can just go right, you know, on that. But I'll go and talk to an, I remember talking to an executive once, and he goes, I would never make an Aquaman movie because I don't get the where did he? I don't understand him. I would greenlight a Man from Atlantis movie because I can take. I swear to God, I can watch a video. Somebody committed that to film. They made a TV show out of that, and I can watch that. But he didn't have the attention span to read a comic book or understand the lore and history of Aquaman.
He might have just been doing a smokescreen for being a huge Patrick Duffy fan.
There might
He's
be.
Like, look, I just get Patrick Duffy.
Well, that you know.
See, Pat, I'm only familiar with Patrick Duffy's work in South Park, where he played that guy's leg.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Well, Step by Step.
Yeah. Oh, not really.
No.
See, I think that, you know, for a while there, like the last 20 years, everybody kind of talked very dismissively about Aquaman. And I think that was because some people made jokes about Aquaman or he became kind of like an easy target on shows like Entourage and everything. And then the executives who never read an Aquaman comic book said, oh, Aquaman is a joke. So we got to do him like that. And so only in the last few years, they're sort of saying, okay, we can.
It's actually pretty rad.
Yeah.
He's actually 2/3 of the Earth under his control.
Yes, he's king of most of the Earth. Yeah.
Pretty fearsome superhero.
Yeah. But, you know, if Entourage makes fun of it, hey.
Yeah,
it must be a joke.
I mean, that's the thing. No, thank you.
When we started on Saturday night, there's a bunch of shows here that had premiered that night, and it's interesting to see, since there is somewhat of an age difference, what you're watching while you're kind of an adult and working basically in the business, although a little bit removed, and you're just a consumer basically,
and a little kid.
And a little kid.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So there's some things that, well so I said when we have couples here, you know, you either end up arguing kind of over and come to a compromise, you pick separately, or, and you just said, Paul will pick and I'm along for the ride.
Yeah. But there were some that I was like, no, we need to watch The Golden Girls.
Right.
I was going to say, like, that was your initial thought, but then once you went along, you had some veto powers.
Right.
I did.
So Saturday night, 7 o'clock. Actually, we're going to start an hour earlier with Hee Haw.
Okay,
I loved Hee Haw and the Statler Brothers around that.
So you really you like Hee Haw? So you grew up in San Francisco and New York mostly.
I was born in New York, and I did most of my growing up outside of San Francisco in a little town called Orinda near Berkeley.
So Hee Haw wasn't alien to you?
No, you know, my dad was a singer, and he sang like Tony Bennett and Eddie Fisher type stuff. Then he got into advertising. My mom always loved country music, so we always listened to it. And there was something about Hee Haw I liked. I liked the weird music. I liked the corny jokes. I liked Little Abner, the comic strip. So that's probably why I liked Hee Haw.
Like the Schmoo.
You like the Schmoo? Yeah.
We all like the Schmoo. The Schmoo, I always liked when they reappropriated the Schmoo for like Herculoids.
Oh, yeah. And there, like, you go.
It's just the Schmoo.
It's the Schmoo. Yeah.
But I, you know, growing up in Boston, I had a real weird aversion to the Southern shows for whatever reason.
Why?
Why the
I
alien?
Don't know. They would air, like Hee Haw especially, and I would just be like, I don't understand. Like, it just
What's
was
What's wrong
so,
with these people?
Yeah, it just, I couldn't. It was so different from anything.
You don't like your humor in the corn.
It's exactly. Yeah. I didn't like, unless it's a Children of the Corn sketch show, which I'm still waiting for.
Let's do that. Yeah. It's time.
Yeah. Malachi had some real chops.
We're overdue.
The thing I have to point out, though, is like the total and almost instantaneous in geological terms extinction of Hee Haw and anything like it, because it went from country for a long time, right up until around this time, right around until the early 90s, was, you know, big, you know, junior samples and bib overalls and girls dressed like Daisy May and, you know, the cornfield and everything, guys in, you know, hillbilly hats and everything. Then suddenly, boom, it suddenly became grotesquely overweight people at Walmart going in
NASCAR.
Yeah. And maybe it was NASCAR that killed it, but no more hillbillies, no more Daisy May, no more hound dogs.
Named Karen in your backseat.
Yeah, there you go. Well, I'll take the mountain lion and Karen.
But they don't look at that like Southern face.
No.
You know what I mean? There's not like a, it's not because the people in that area and all the people I know who grew up there are like ashamed of it or anything. It's just like America didn't like that. That sort of caricature anymore, something like that.
Right. I mean, we used to spend holidays up at a friend's ranch up in Nevada sometimes. And I remember when I was about 18, or you know, maybe even a little younger, there was a bar, there was a saloon, and you know, a bar and a place you could get a hamburger. And you walk in, there were guys dressed like cowboys and farmers and everything like that. And then I went back about 10 years ago, and everybody's dressed like in button-down shirts, and they all sell like pool filters and they are real estate and they're
cell phone accessories.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And yet they're the same guys who grew up with all that. It's just, it just vanished completely. And it's still the country, but it's got this weird sort of,
It's harder to be isolated now.
Yeah.
I think the world is so much smaller that even, you know, in the Hee Haw country, you have the internet. And so they can kind of, it's harder to be years behind and stuff. And they don't take up, people don't take pride as much now in like, we'd never change.
Yeah.
Unless you're like a hipster who's like, no, I don't have a TV. It's like almost like a totally weird thing. And I remember one of my favorite Christmas specials of all time is 1990s Dolly's Christmas Down Home.
Oh,
where she's walking around Dollywood and she has the Dollywood mascot, and she actually calls him, I forget his name, but she calls him, it's our ridiculous hillbilly from Dollywood. Like, that's the character's name.
Yeah.
And he's all like, oh, hi, Dolly. And I'm like, yeah, but even then, it seems really archaic. Like,
right.
This is weird. But it is odd how that totally disappeared. They tried to do a new Hee Haw, though, in the late 90s.
Yeah, urban Hee Haw.
Yeah.
Ooh.
It was like in living color
Hee Haw. Yeah.
It was real weird.
That's not a good idea at all.
No.
No, it didn't.
And it wasn't.
Back to our Children of the Corn comedy
special. I enjoy this. Yeah, we get Isaac and he hosts, and really good. Although, you know, you can't do that on television. May have been the closest thing to Children of the Corn comedy special.
That was
I don't know.
Yeah.
Bark.
It was one of the reasons I thought, you know, if I ever perform and ever get famous, it's all my ambition to go on Hee Haw and say, Hee Haw salutes my hometown, Orinda, California, population 14,000. Salute. So I don't think they'll ever get it, but so I'm just.
You know,
I'm
next on camera interview.
What?
You do. Yeah. I don't even care who it's for or what it's for.
Just spit it
you
out.
You just
there.
Have to do it.
Hee Haw salutes my hometown, Orinda, California. Okay, great.
Please.
Great.
They'll be like, okay.
All right.
They're going to leave it in.
Yeah. It'd be funny if we just found out that Hee Haw actually never stopped. They just stopped filming it.
Yeah.
So it's like all the people from Hee Haw are in this studio every week doing the show for no one.
Call BL534.
I'd believe it. Like just the lost. They're like the Japanese soldiers on islands after the war ended.
Yeah.
Oh wow. Now I'm really. This could be a thing. I would like this. Yeah. Hee Haw reunion movie. So you're going with Hee Haw at 6. Yeah. You got to tune in for Hee Haw.
And we're holding our Sears WishBooks.
Yep. Yeah. Sears WishBook ad was in
Sears WishBooks.
There's an ad in there for that.
Yep.
All freaked out.
Yeah. Because at the time I would have been about
24.
And I'm still going through the wish book, circling everything that I want for Christmas that year.
Yeah.
And
so for the people that don't know what the wish book is, I don't know what you're
It was a phone book size Sears catalog. Mm-hmm. They had 3 or 4 Sears catalogs a year for every quarter. And the wish book was their Christmas one, and it had the toy section. So all the other ones were just closed.
And
basically.
They were tapped, right?
Like
toys.
Yeah.
And
it's
you
a huge,
oh, I know exactly where to go.
It weighed like 20 pounds.
Yeah.
It was enormous. And it was toys. A lot of them, I found out later, were toys that never even got produced. So what they would do basically is say, if we get people to pre-order enough of these in the wish book, we'll actually make these toys.
But
they didn't. So a lot of times you see like the only existing photo of this toy line that never happened is in the Sears wish book.
That's why I never got my Western Animal set.
That's why. Yeah.
Because I had a set and I really wanted it one year. It's like Animals of the Old West. And it was like plastic action figures. It was a grizzly bear, a mountain lion, and a longhorn steer. And I said, I really want this. I never did.
Yeah. They just didn't, you know, you were probably the only person that ordered it or something.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
But then they'd have these
the Hee Haw kid wants the grizzly bear and the cow.
I want this Hee Haw action playset.
Yeah.
And they don't have it. But it was really weird. And they'd have like beds shaped like race car. Just things no kid would ever have.
Yeah. I'm looking at the animals of the old
Okay.
West. No, I've looked. They never made it. I've looked and I've looked and they
Hey, listener, why don't you make Paul an Animals of the Old West playset? We'll do an Etsy's custom set.
No, like I can get a plastic grizzly bear and a
It's not the same. It's not the same.
I don't know. I have to look at the original catalog again. And that would have been from like 1970 or something.
And we had service merchandise as well in the Boston area. Yes.
Yeah.
Which is the same thing. And you would go and you'd write on a piece of paper the thing you wanted.
Yeah.
And it would come down on the conveyor belt.
Oh,
it was
God,
really weird. Yeah.
Yeah.
You'd go into a store and flip through a catalog in the store, which was very strange.
Mm-hmm.
That would be like walking into Amazon today and like it would just
sort of
like
yeah,
a, like
yeah.
a drone
you know
would fly it
you,
out to you
when you order at White Castle. They deliver it like the bank tube.
I never figured out how does that go. Does that go underground or overground?
No, it goes up and over. And
down. Oh, it's that pneumatic tube.
Yeah, it's just like a big buggy, a cart, and they just put all your junk in this giant cart. You put your money in a cup.
And then
you send it just like you do at the bank.
Yeah.
And then they put your food, they get your money, they put your food, they put in the cart, they put your change in the cup, and then they send it back to you.
Do you want
to
eat with nobody? No human interaction eating?
None at all.
Hey, and today is
service merchandise is very much
speaking of White Castle, you remember White Castle Super Bowl Sunday?
In a hot tub.
Our first
Janet Jackson year.
Yeah, Janet. Oh, yeah, Justin Timberlake, Janet Jackson.
We watched that in a hot tub.
Really? Eating White Castle?
Eating White Castle.
Eating White Castle.
Wow, that's the best possible way. I don't even like the Super Bowl, and
that
sounds like
a good
date.
That was a great date.
Janet Jackson's boob in a hot tub in White Castle.
I think
we also had pizza.
Why not?
White Castle pizza?
No.
I'd like a large pizza with White
Castle. And White Castle.
That is
it was
decadence.
Gluttony in a hot tub.
Yeah.
And a boob. Yeah.
You've just described America. That is the American dream.
I think there were
people. Is alive. Yeah.
And the motel. I think there were people getting shot outside the parking lot.
I'm sure.
That was
really
ungrassious.
Bad area.
So.
I worked at the local CBS affiliate on the audience complaint line that year.
How did that work out for you?
Oh, I was in college and that was my job. And I got the most hilarious old people phone calls of just, and it's Boston too. So
can
like,
you please make that your new podcast.
Yeah, just
hilarious
the calls.
Old people phone calls. Can
I
that
do
please?
I wish I saved them. I wish I saved them because they would just. Oh, and it was Boston, so you get like since it's Janet Jackson, a lot of them would be like really old racist phone calls.
Oh,
it was just amazing, and I almost got fired from that job because we were not supposed to talk to the media. Obviously, I'm like 20 and I don't care. And I'm like a punk rock kid who's like, I don't know. And they were always, it's the apocalypse when a snowstorm's coming in Boston because they want to show the weatherman 24 hours a day. So even if it doesn't come, they're just like, hey, but batten down the hatches. And we didn't have a snowstorm that they've been talking about for 4 days. It's going to be a snowstorm. Mm. Old people. Out of control yelling at me. So someone
old
from
people.
The yeah.
Out of control.
Oh yeah.
Autobiography.
Old people
Henry.
Are the masters of like unwitting, probably not meaning it, racism.
They just don't even know it's a thing.
Yeah,
oh, certainly.
Yeah.
And they would just call and just immediately start yelling at you.
Yeah.
And
well, it's like the black girl showed her nipple or something like that.
What is this? You can't even get white nipples on your television these days.
So racist and sexist.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
That was one. But they were so mad that the snowstorm never happened. And the Boston Globe called. Yeah, because they were like, I canceled my plans. My grandson was going to visit. You're not here now. It was crazy. Or if it did snow, they would be like, you caused this. Like, you could never win.
Now, I lived in Boston, bro. I lived in
a complaint line at our house.
Yeah, do it.
You just like leave the number of places and just pick it up. It was like, can I get all your personal information? Yeah. We'll get right back with you.
Yes, we'll send you that.
I remember snowstorms in Boston. I lived in Cambridge and going to stock up at the local market.
Oh, it's the apocalypse. Yeah. It's like the mist.
Yep. Our local market was a gourmet food store called Savinor's.
Still there.
Yep. And it's like, there's going to be a snowstorm. Okay, I'm going to need some zebra, rattlesnake.
Oh, this pate.
Steve, you want some kangaroo? How are they fixed for a hippo? I'll get the hippo.
How long can I make this barracuda last?
They had wild game there. They had this huge, it was like exotic game from all over the world. So my roommate and I, Steve Langford, we'd barricade ourselves in, and it's like, and we eat like caveman. Hippo, I'm still working on my lion.
Can I chew on that elephant leg you got over there?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's still there, and they still have those things.
Oh, God.
So the Globe called.
Oh, yeah.
And they were like, hey, and I think they might have said they were from the Globe, but I didn't really, wasn't really paying attention. And they were like, have people been calling and complaining? And I'm like, oh, yeah, these damn old people. And then they quoted me in the paper.
Oh, boy.
As like, CBS Boston employee Ken Reed says, these damn old people.
Oh, boy.
So
please put that in your publicity.
I need to find it. I need to find it.
These damn old people. Yeah. There's a podcast.
Yeah, these
title.
Damn old people.
It's
these
like the Tom Lehrer, you know. Yeah. Mr. Lehrer is unfettered by such things as taste.
Exactly.
It's like, this, I want those quotes so bad in my publicity stuff. You have no idea. You've got to find it.
I
got to
find it
because
it was in there. It's got to be on microfilm. Yeah. And we had to hide that day's paper from the GM of the company.
Oh boy.
And he was like, because he couldn't go, I guess he didn't understand you could look him up online, so like we just didn't get the paper that day. And it was real fun.
Oh, that's great.
Are we still on Saturday?
I think so. What else do we get after that? So
we didn't talk about Airwolf.
Airwolf.
We're right here. We're Ewoks and Droids / Sears Wishbook. It isn't even 7 o'clock.
Oh my Saturday. Dear God. Yeah. Yeah. Well, people enjoy this. It's
Airwolf,
fun chat.
Ernest Borgnine.
Jan Michael Vincent.
In a helicopter, I believe.
It was
Blue Thunder.
Yeah. Well, it was more like Knight Rider helicopter.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Because everyone was like, everyone knows this Knight Rider show. Yeah. Let's rip it off with various forms of transportation.
Okay.
So you had Street Hawk.
Yeah. That's right.
And Mantis.
Yep.
And Airwolf. There was no boat one. Was there a boat one? There was no super boat show.
Well, there was a boat in Miami Vice, wasn't there?
It wasn't sentient.
No, it wasn't.
So they missed a trick there. Yeah. And then it was the premiere of Golden Girls that night.
Yeah.
Which you hate, Paul.
I despise.
And I love. Okay.
Oh, let's get into this a little.
Oh,
what?
I carry my purse like Sophia and I shuffle around like that. And I'm not sure if I was inspired by her or if we're just kindred. I am an old, crabby person at my core. See, I should be calling your line.
Yeah, you should be calling and being like, in 1984, why isn't Golden Girls a thing yet?
Every day, yes.
But if why I do you hate
it? I want that on the channel every single day. I don't need this Airwolf shit.
And now we're PG. Oh.
But Ernest Borgnine. Borgnine was basically Golden Girls.
Oh, and you know what else? I actually liked it so much, and a friend of mine, Trish, loves it so much. I bought her prayer candles.
Yeah, with
of the
Golden ladies.
Girls, like they turned them into the saints, you know, and like.
So I understand why you love
it.
It
wasn't my thing.
Why just it? You just couldn't identify. It was like your Hee Haw.
It was.
My dad hated it too. He called it the Olden Girls, and he was like, "Why do people watch this?"
It was like a parade of pastel and hairspray and regret.
So the Miami was what did it.
And regret and weirdness.
And regret and weirdness. And if I wanted to listen to that, I would listen to my mom yakking with her twin sister, then I could get it in stereo. Two old ladies yelling.
So it was too. It hit too close to home for you, is what you're saying.
Well, no, actually, my mom and her sister were kind of entertaining. But you know, I don't know. I guess it was like when which one's the one who had a lot of sex?
Or Blanche. Clint?
Oh, yeah, Blanche.
Did you ever have sex, really? I can't.
That was a little gross.
So because you didn't find Blanche sexy, you had a problem? You misogynist.
I know.
Ageist.
If Blanche had been sexier, I would have been all over it.
Guys, all right, I admit it. If it was guys talking about their sexual conquests, I would have watched. But old ladies made me feel uncomfortable because I couldn't visualize it. It was just weird and alien.
What if Blanche was Catherine Helmand? Of Who's the Boss fame, who was the horny
Mona,
and wasn't attractive.
It's not
lady.
Better. Look
it's not better.
It's
okay.
Not better.
Well, that makes me feel better. It wasn't just a physical look of Blanche thing.
Could we recast with Anne Ramsey from Goonies and her boyfriend is Ernest Borgnine?
I'm into it.
Because that would be like watching rhinos go out.
Yeah, I'm into it. But I, you know what? If it was. If
That was Anne Ramsey in Goonies. Wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah. Okay. Sean Astin told me she, quote, did her own grunting.
Oh. Fratelli?
The Fratellis. Fratelli. Yeah, the Fratellis. Fratelli, yeah. Joey Pants, one of the Fratelli brothers.
Joey Pants. Sounds like a fake thing, but it was real.
Yep.
Love Chunk.
Yes, I love that movie.
Truffle Smuggle.
Yeah, Truffle Shuffle.
Yeah, that's
yes, correct. The original Fat Shaming. That's the Truffle Shuffle.
Butterfinger. Yeah.
Baby Ruth.
Baby Ruth.
Because fat kids exist to be made fun of, as Steven Spielberg.
Absolutely they do, apparently.
Steven Spielberg's got a big problem with the overweight.
It's a very Hong Kong style comedy.
Yeah.
Like, it's just like, it's really weird, old fashioned. I feel like if Spielberg could get away with giving them a beanie and a giant lollipop in all his movies, he would do it.
Maybe the Fat Fury.
Yes.
Fall of 2018.
Yeah, nothing's funnier than the fat kid.
Yes.
The first thing you see in Indiana Jones, The Last Crusade, fat.
Yeah.
He's ruddy like, face fat.
This is gold. Yeah. You can't go wrong with it. And in Schindler's List, they open with that fat kid.
Schindler's List also hilarious.
It was uncomfortable. You know, I was like, why are you, I don't understand this. So
Hobby has a real thing about this. He says, Steven Spielberg, always open up. Our friend Hobby.
What? Why? What?
He says that's Steven Spielberg's hallmark. Always make fun of, open on a fat kid, make fun of him. And then you've got the audience. Well, that's what Hobby.
Yeah, it's not Steven Spielberg officially isn't like teaching a class and
he's
be like,
a book.
All right, the overweight in film. Let me tell you how
Chapter
to do this.
One,
yes.
Start on a funny fat kid.
Yeah. Let me tell you. When
the
I was
your face, the better.
Here's some deleted scenes from Duel. People ask me, Steven, what was that truck carrying? This kid's food. They cut it out. I hit him like, what do you do? This is horrible. Why are you so cruel?
The first scene is Dennis Weaver back in the car out over a fat kid on a bike. Oh, sorry, fat kid.
Yes. So the thing is, the truck's not chasing him. The truck is running from a fat kid. It's a subtext I did not put in the film.
The truck is actually filled with fat kids.
Oh, God. Did you ever see the Garbage Pail Kids movie?
No.
Yeah, I did. Actually, I admit that.
Did you write it?
Man.
No.
Then that movie.
I was have to ask because half the time he did.
You wrote it? Yeah. I did. I did a pass on it.
You ever seen Double Dragon? I wrote it.
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Yes.
That was
I don't know. I won't say what I was going to say about it. No.
Okay.
But the Garbage Pail Kids movie has a state home for the ugly.
Yeah.
Oh.
In it.
Where do I sign up?
Yeah, and you'd be all right because these are like alligator children.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just to view them like the human zoo.
But do they have glass walls?
They do. Perfect. So the whole movie is like the government's trying to capture these kids to put them in the state home for the ugly, and they're trying to break them out. And then in this state home for the ugly is like Santa Claus.
Wow.
And I'm like, is this pro or con? I don't understand what you're trying to share here as a message.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like having the woods where there's a unicorn. And
yeah. It's very
it's
weird.
Like, why are they all in
Who
here?
Are the real monsters?
I remember hearing about the Garbage Pail Kids. Like, they ran out of money halfway through, and they were only able to make, you know, not all the Garbage Pail Kids they wanted to. So at one point, Anthony Newley, who's the star of the Garbage Pail movies, says, well, we can't rescue these Garbage Pail Kids. And he rattles off a bunch of them that were supposed to appear in the movie, but they ran out of money and they couldn't make the costumes or models of them.
So they said, we can't rescue
them? It all happened off screen.
And they all die, basically.
Yeah, they all die. Yeah.
Here are some really cool ones that die.
Yeah.
It'd be like a Pokemon movie where they were like, here's three Pokemon, and here's all some other ones we're to name that are all dead.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
It's like Poochie going back to his home planet. Before he says anything, they lift the cell up.
He's just gone. Yeah.
The Simpson.
Oh
yeah.
When you say, listen, I'm a little kid in the 80s. When you say Poochie, I think of a pink-haired little white dog.
Oh, yes, Poochie.
I think of Poochie from The Simpsons. Wiggly, wiggly.
Yeah.
Yours is better.
Yeah, well.
But mine was
a pink-haired little white dog is pretty rad. Yeah, it's like Rude Dog in the Dweebs.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I remember Rude Dog. there you're getting into like early 90s.
Yeah.
Early
89, it's a dog with attitude.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there you go.
Spuds McKenzie.
Spuds McKenzie. Yeah, they were basically like, can we take this beer mascot and make him a children's cartoon?
And
they did.
And Target was like, actually, you know what? We'll also take him and appropriate him and put a little Target on his eye.
And if this works out, Joe Campbell the series is going to be huge.
Yeah.
All the kids will be smoking.
Yeah.
Four and a half.
I pitched Ishtar the cartoon.
Yeah.
And I got Joe Campbell in there. And there's a genie.
Yeah.
It's working.
Ishtar the cartoon.
Joe Campbell always has a lollipop in his mouth. He takes it out to show it's a lollipop, but it goes back in.
Yeah.
So you just see the white stick.
Yeah.
So subliminally, the kids.
And the magic comes out of the end.
That's
out.
Where the genie comes out.
It'd be funny if you found out that Disney's Aladdin started as a Joe Camel cartoon.
Yeah.
Someone came in and pitched it. They bought it, and it slowly evolved into Aladdin.
I do know that Aladdin was originally a vehicle for Mickey Mouse.
Was it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Because I went in for
a pitch meeting to animation, like right around the time they were releasing Little Mermaid. Mm-hmm. And they had all this art on the wall of Mickey, Donald, and Goofy going around the old bazaar in Baghdad and finding the magic lamp. And then it changed into more of the traditional Aladdin.
That'd
story.
Be really interesting to see, because they were kind of making a comeback in animation at Disney, and it would have been like, this is the one where we get our characters back in a movie, which I don't think they did till the Goofy movie.
You know, that a lot of movies have started out as a vehicle. They look at everything as a vehicle for Mickey, you know, like the big stories, like, you know, classic stories like Treasure Island, they thought about with Mickey. Robin Hood was like a vehicle for Mickey at one point throughout the studio's history. They finally did the Three Musketeers with Mickey, but, you know, it's like, how do we bring back Mickey? And a lot of times is, we don't know who this character is.
Right.
You know, what is he? Is he a hero? Is he a scamp? Is he, you know, a nice little guy? So they look for vehicles to put him in, and then they get something like Three Musketeers or Christmas Carol, where you can put him in a stock role and have everybody fill in around him. And I think they were going to do the same with Aladdin, but then they realized, you know what, let's just
do it as Aladdin, have a new property. Yeah, there's a Boston comic named Gary Gulman who has a great bit about where he's just like, Mickey Mouse isn't anyone's favorite character. No one's like, remember that funny thing Mickey Mouse did?
Yeah.
He never did anything funny. He's not in any cartoons. He's not Bugs Bunny.
No.
There's no cartoons you can see. And he's just, and I'm like, no, you're right. And I have looked.
Among cartoon geeks, I can tell you one funny thing that Mickey Mouse did. And that is in the Cartoon Symphony Hour, where he's playing a band leader and he's trying to do a serious thing. The instruments gets crushed and suddenly they're on trying to play serious music. The instruments are crushed and it all comes out sounding like Spike Jones. Donald Duck is in process of quitting and he actually kind of, you know, packs up his stuff and leaves. And before he can get to the door, Mickey zooms in front of him, pulls out a huge gun and shoves it in his face, and Donald runs back and finishes.
Oh, so murder is
funny. Murder is funny. Yeah, all right. Mickey with a gun in his hand is hysterically funny.
Well,
you don't expect it.
A lot of people don't know Leon the Professional started as a Mickey Mouse vehicle. The Luc Besson movie.
Yeah.
And then they recast it.
Yeah.
Natalie Portman was supposed to be Donald Duck.
Oh, there.
Oh, yeah, very good casting.
Yeah, that's very good.
Are you Young Ones fans? The Young Ones, the British.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I've been trying to equate the Young Ones to Golden Girls and figure out who is who, but someday I'll figure it out. So
now Golden Girls, you like them? I'm too hard on him.
This
I appreciate
true
the
love.
Writing.
Like, you're really trying.
He really is. He's a good guy. Yeah. He's a good guy. And he knows that he's largely intolerant of things that inconvenience or dismay him. And the Golden Girls is one of those, but he also knows I'm terribly fond of it. And so he's really trying to wrap his mind around it. And he's been trying for about 10 years now.
He's struggling. Yeah.
To really work it out. And he's having a problem.
Our friend Chris Lloyd, who created Modern Family, I believe
and Frasier.
I believe that was his first job. He was writing on the Golden Girls.
They had a pretty killer writing staff on that show.
He was like 23 when he would have been writing on Golden Girls.
I was watching one earlier today, and it was really funny. Rose had to do a roast of a local newscaster at some event, and it was really sharp, like funny jokes where she couldn't think of anything, and he started dating Blanche. So the guy's mother came over to tell Blanche to get away from him, and she's like, "He can't be with you. He can't go to the bathroom anywhere but his own house, and he's afraid of clowns and in the dark and all this stuff."
Like,
no, Rose was like, "I can't think of anything about it." That was like the joke where he had all these things.
Uh-huh.
It was so funny, and then she goes, "Here's my opening joke. I hope you guys like the Cornish game hens." And B. Arthur was like, I don't understand. She goes, "Oh, I have to set it up. We're having Cornish game hens at the event." She goes, "Okay." She goes, "That's it." And it was just like these really funny, weird things that were kind of playing with sitcom jokes.
Right.
Where it was much more knowing than your average sitcom.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what's interesting is they actually had a group where all those people, like the guy from Tom from Newhart, Betty White, B. Arthur, and all those people used to go and get together. There was a Pacific Radio Broadcasters. Do you know what
that
is?
Oh, yeah.
The Pacific Radio Broadcasters group, and they would get up on the dais and make fun of each other. They would do this.
They were
roast.
All friends. Like,
oh,
it was, yeah.
And we went
showbiz.
To one.
Oh, wow.
We got to go to one. And it was it Tom that they were? I know
Tom Poston?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He spoke. Mm-hmm. I think, who else was there? I can't remember who they were after.
Wow.
But it was like and it was quick.
Yeah.
And every one of them was hysterical, and they all just one after the other just got up and went bam, bam.
Their
bam.
Chops were unbelievable.
Whoa, were they honed and refined? Yeah. And I was sitting there going, "Holy Christmas, these people are professional."
Well, here's the thing.
I mean, they were so funny, and it was a lot of it was just right off the cuff.
Yeah.
I mean, they were just like, "Oh yeah, remember that time we did that? Remember when you screwed that up?" And I mean, it was just Our friend Mark Nelson took us to a lunch there.
Yeah. Oh, well, here's the thing about Golden Girls. Okay, I wasn't the biggest fan of the show, you know, but
you're allowed to hate it, dear.
I don't hate it because I actually felt it.
No, he does hate it.
You know, I think the reason it kind of turned me off is I liked Sophia. I thought she was really funny.
Yes.
But I felt bad for the other characters because every guy they were dating died. It always seemed like I was turning on the scene. Oh, I was dating this guy and he died. Oh, everybody's dying on the show.
That's old age, man.
I know. But
so it reminded you of mortality, and that's where you... It was an existential crisis you had with Golden Girls.
It was too mature for your young tastes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Not only did you not want to shtook the old ladies, but also while their boyfriends were croaking.
Yeah.
And you're like, this is too much for me to handle croaking in my sitcom.
It does fix the sex thing if their boyfriends are dead.
Indeed.
Hopefully.
Oh, I almost just went in a
yeah, I'm
bad.
Sure. I'm sure. Yeah. We were all thinking
to
it.
Crack open a cold
yep,
one.
Yep. Ooh, we'll add that to the just the tips box.
And that's not the one I was going to give you. Yeah. That's cleaner than what I was going to say.
You went Spuds McKenzie on that one.
But here's what I mourn is that there are no shows like that anymore.
Right.
Like there is no, like if you are over 31, you are banned from television.
I disagree. I think that there are shows like that, but now there are a lot, a lot more reality. Sunny in Philadelphia. It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
Yeah.
Well, I would say that I think that in the mid-80s, it was not okay to have a show about five women living together. And so the only way they could get around it was they're old and they're widowers or whatever.
Well, there's designing women.
But the facts of life, they were still like...
young and being cared for.
Yeah, they were under the guise of Mrs. Garrett.
Yeah.
Whereas now you get a show like New Girl or something like that where it's basically a similar dynamic, but it's okay to have, you know, some 20-somethings or friends or that, you know, it seems more okay without a conceit.
Yeah.
Well, and we're in a different spot. I mean, there was like horse blinders on everybody back.
Yes.
Also, there are a lot more choices. Like, you can still, you can come up with more interesting and diverse ideas for sitcoms on cable, you know, and on some of the other networks, because most of the networks are pretty, I don't know, I don't watch a lot of network TV because it's like talent shows and reality shows. And the sitcoms they're on are few and far between.
Well, because
they're all the same.
Stuff has changed to event television because of DVRs. They have to do stuff that is live and you need to, you know, it's sports. It's a sports model.
Yeah,
you know,
that's true.
If you missed it, you can't watch it on DVR because you missed the big reveal. And so everyone...
And you'll get spoiled in the morning. So they want you to sit and tune in. You know, that's a really good point. I've never really heard it put that way.
They have to do that. It's
someone and I, we were talking about it the other day. And I said, I feel like we are in entertainment kind of at the same crossroads that they were years ago when vaudeville and talkies were battling it out.
Yep, absolutely.
And now it's sort of like, are we going to go internet? Are we still going to do this? And how do you navigate that? And even more so, how do you monetize it?
Yeah.
And people are really like, I'm really curious to see what's going to push forward and become the working model and how fast that's going to happen because it's morphing so fast and it's so nebulous right now.
Yeah, and nobody knows. No one has a handle on it.
And there's all these YouTube celebrities that are getting paid X number of dollars to Instagram a picture of themselves with a Mountain Dew, and yet how long is that going to last? Only as long as their followers are up and responsive.
Yeah.
And so it's fleeting and fame is so instant. It's so fleeting. We were just talking about the instantaneous
Well, somebody who might have like millions of followers online and yet they're working two jobs just to pay the rent.
Or I have a very good friend who's a YouTube celebrity and has hundreds of thousands of followers on Twitter and is always doing other things to, you know, they're doing cross hybridization and, you know, you bring your followers, I'll bring mine and all this stuff. Makes $80,000 a year, works a 16-hour day, 7 days.
Yeah.
He produces six YouTube shows. And she's very happy with that money.
But that's a real hustle. Yeah.
And I'm like, that's a lot more work than I would do. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And yet she's famous and I'm not. You know what I mean? It's really interesting.
It seems so weird and ephemeral. It's like dancing on moonbeams, you know, of fame, you know, like millions of people watch and yet I couldn't get a meeting at CBS, you know? Mm-hmm.
Exactly what's happening.
Yeah.
I just read an article. Was it Vanity Fair, I think, just ran an article about current YouTube celebrities and how they're trying to run over into the movie market.
Right. They don't know how to make it into... The other thing that's interesting now that I think is a bubble and will not do well is that because of all these, you know, CISO and Amazon and Hulu and Netflix are all in this arms race and they're like, we're going to lose money, but we just want to be the last man standing and we just want to have the most content or be the sort of seal of quality content so that we're the good one and then everyone else goes out of business. So they're just dumping money into stuff. And it reminds me of the early days of cable when there was so much air to fill. They just wanted content. So some great stuff is getting through because they're just like, just do it. It might work. I don't know anything, but it'll burst. And then the next thing that happens after that is, I don't know. You know, that's where
start showing commercials on Netflix.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
what's going to start happening. Yeah. Well, because that's what happened with cable.
Yeah.
You know, here's pay TV. No commercials. Oh, but there's going to be commercials in between the shows.
Just a couple.
Now we're going to stick them in the middle. Yeah. And they're just for us.
Yeah.
And now it's for other people. Now we're doing product placement. And we're stopping in the middle, and it's just like, oh my God.
You know, in some ways, TV was like the, you know, we got to TV, traditional network TV too soon, because it was like the internet should have come along, and that should have been like gold rush time, and then gone on network television, and that's how you make your money. But it's, you can be a huge star online, and yet everybody's attitude is like, so what? I see it for free. You're on there twice a week with new content. I don't have to pay anything.
It's like if Tesla's idea of just free energy beat them to the punch, and then Edison comes along and is like, I can bring it right to your house. It would cost you a little money. I'm like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
Why would I
Why
do
would
that?
Pay
yeah.
I mean, I'm like 15, 16 years ago, I remember a lot of animators were saying, thank God for the internet. It's going to be a golden age of creativity because finally we won't have the networks. We won't have sensors. We can do whatever we want. And that never happened because it's so damn expensive to make animation. It needs the funding for it to exist, for it to be even kind of good, you need a corporation, you know, paying the animators, you know, even just trying to use music.
They're not going to do that to be an arts patron. They're only going to do that if they can make money.
Yeah. Right. And so it's like, they'll say, yeah, I'll fund your internet cartoon and I'm going to own all, you know, the IP.
And we're going to run an ad beforehand.
Yeah. You know what? We just hired somebody who's going to kind of go over your scripts. And oh, yes, you will be writing scripts.
Yeah.
And meet our censor and everything.
But I mean, it's like this podcast, you know, I lose money on this every week.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. We did one too.
Yeah, but it's like, it's my favorite thing that I've ever done. And, you know, and it's also the, you know, that gets the most penetration of the world with this thing. And it's like,
you get a really fun roster.
It's fun, yeah.
It's a really good idea to break the ice. And
it's
not awkward. Like, so, how's it going?
It's Chris Farley Shale style. Yeah. And it's the kind of thing where people keep it like, you could do that for a living. You have X amount. And I'm like, it's a best of time, worst of time.
Yeah,
where,
totally. And where, I get the same thing. We just did a documentary. I did a documentary with Vice. They came and followed the girls and I around just to see what it was like to be a female magician.
Right.
It's so novel. Whatever, and it was fun, but as a result I get a couple, at least a few calls about doing reality shows a month.
Yeah.
And I got a note from we went to Deal Memo something, they sent it, and I read it and went, are you kidding me? We own everything. You have absolutely no privacy. We're gonna follow you even when you think you should, i.e. in the bathroom, in the vehicle, and nowhere. And it says even when you think you should, like in the deal.
Jeez.
No privacy. We own everything. You own nothing. You give us everything for a year, and I think it was like 10 years in the vault at that.
Well, the craziest thing isn't that that's the agreement. The craziest thing is people sign it.
Well, yeah, I remember a guy.
And I said, oh, hell yeah. No. And I sent them back a note that said, thank you very much for this.
Not
it's
for me.
It's insulting.
Yeah.
This is not appropriate for me. And they wrote back and said, what would you change?
Everything.
And I wrote back and said, the following points. And she said, our lawyer wants to talk to you. We're ready to try to make a deal. And I'm like, you know, and I was thinking about it and I thought, what do I need you for?
Yeah.
Why can't I just hire a camera crew?
Yeah.
To follow us around, edit it so my finger's on the editing button and pitch it myself.
That's what I've been like, and comics think I'm crazy. I've turned down all kinds of deals and stuff. They think I'm nuts, and I'm like, but this is not a good deal. Or like putting on an album.
Yeah.
I'm like, you don't understand, for a very small investment, you can just do it yourself and you own the whole thing. Like there's no, it's a little more work and you have to front the money, a little bit of money.
It's easier than it's ever been.
Yeah. And it's weird.
I've run into that in cartooning and there are times I have a file full of characters that I've never sold and that I've had a lot of offers on simply because, you know, I just hated the deal and I hated the idea of basically what you were doing is taking a box of kittens and offering them for free in front of the supermarket. Yeah. Like 25 years ago, there was a major kids network starting up and I had a meeting with them and I took in some sketches and they said, we're not wild about the format you put this character in, but we love the character. You want to come back? Can you just make the show about this character? And I said, okay. And they go, and here's our deal memo. And I'm like,
yeah.
Oh my God. What's this part about firstborn child and sign and blood? Yeah. It's a standard deal. And that night I went over to a cartoonist friend's house and he said, did you do the pitch to the network? And I said, yeah, did you? And he goes, yeah, they didn't like every idea of mine, but they liked this dog and cat character or sideline characters. And I think I'm going to make the deal. And I said, are you serious? He goes, I don't care about this, these characters.
And yeah.
We're just, they're just sideline characters. And I said, you know, you will at some point. Yeah. You know, they did. And later on, he ran into some trouble over that. But I just said, I'm going to take my character and go home. I'm going to stay working with Bugs Bunny and Batman because they can take those characters away from me and you know, at some point. Yeah. And I don't really care.
Yeah.
But
it's not as personal to you now. It's not coming total. You don't want to get John Fogerty'd. You don't want to get sued for ripping off your own music and lose.
Yeah. Yeah. You know,
that's the craziest thing I could think of.
I don't want to turn in the first cartoon and have somebody coming in. Right. Love it. Big fan. Oh, these are the new guys doing the cartoon. You're out. Yeah. We're going to still put your name on there somewhere.
Did you ever see the show, The Famous Teddy Z?
Yes. I love that show. Love God, that what show. A buried treasure. I love that
amazing
show.
Amazing show.
About a young agent, about a young ethical agent.
And he was in the mailroom, and he basically, a Marlon Brando type actor, he's driving him, and the guy's a real dick, and he decks him.
Yeah.
And so he goes, oh, you're going to be my new agent now.
Yeah.
So Alex Rocco's the old agent, but there's an episode that is so good about this kind of thing. This couple comes in, they pitch a documentary show about poor people in South America. Uh-huh. And by the end of the show is now about a woman in a tube top with a talking dolphin.
Uh-huh.
But throughout the show, it makes sense how it gets there because it's one exec comes in and be like, maybe we need this. And they're like, okay. And they're agreeing to stuff. But it's so well done because you're in the in the episode. You're like, yeah. And you go, I kind of get how this happened.
Yeah.
But if you just say from here to here, it's crazy. But they logically, I'm like, I assume this happens all the time.
It does.
Alex Rocco played the greatest sleazy agent, slimy.
Al Floss.
And I think there was one episode, and it's one of my favorite endings of any sitcom, where they piss off a client of theirs, and it's a chimp.
Yeah.
And he has to apologize. And the last shot is Alex Rocco following the chimp down the beach, trying to talk him into coming back.
Yeah. It's a great show.
But it was
1990, and it got canceled and won an Emmy a year after it was canceled.
It was really funny because there are sometimes when show business people are able to take out their anger on the business.
Yeah.
They can do something really funny, but nobody else gets it.
Yeah.
Because it, as weird as it is, everybody thinks of Hollywood still, with all the jokes about it, as being kind of like the end of the Muppet movie. You know, like a movie, write your own ending. You know, they want to believe that Hollywood is rainbow's end.
Yeah.
But what it really is venal and awful. And
a 9-to-5 slog. Like these guys are in an office slogging. And it was perfect. It was such a funny show. And one of the other things I love about that show is that, you know, to old people being on TV, they wanted to make a show about a not that likable old man character.
Yeah.
And the network's not going to green like that.
Yeah.
So they go, oh, it's about this young guy, John Cryer, and they greenlit it. And by like the third episode, he's not really in the show very much anymore. And it's almost all about Alex Rocco, which is unbelievable bait and switch that they managed to kind of get.
Yeah, Dabney Coleman, you know, they would bring him back on TV every once in a while, like Buffalo Bill and everything.
Yep.
But, you know, old crotchy guy, they're very funny, but they don't really get the heart.
The family doesn't want to watch Darren McGavin yell at people.
No.
I do.
I certainly do.
Yeah. I do.
I have a list that there's a couple of weird lists that I keep just in my brain that are only for me, I guess. And it's like my favorite yelling old men.
Yeah.
Eddie Albert.
Oh,
no one does rage like him. Yep.
Love him.
Darren McGavin. And then my other list is songs recorded after Elvis died that I would like to hear Elvis do.
Mm. Ah, what's on that list?
We have Purple Rain.
Yeah.
Oingo Boingo's Stay.
Okay.
The Human League's Human.
Okay.
So it's a lot of that kind of stuff. Just I'm like, someday this it's a fun list.
Yeah, it's a really good
never
idea.
Happen even if I become
an
eccentric billionaire
an impersonator to do
yeah I want like a full Vegas style 100-piece orchestra
when you, yes absolutely yeah. Not only do the recording but do it like on a milestone birthday so your friends have to show up and endure this situation that you've created.
Did you ever hear of a band called Big Daddy?
Yes.
They kind of do that like the modern music done in the old style.
Oh, there's so many great songs that would have been fantastic there. Yeah. Billy Ocean's There'll Be Sad Songs.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Really hear Elvis belting
that
out.
Get out of my dreams and into my car.
Yeah. Or Loverboy. Yeah.
Oh, hello.
Really any Billy Ocean.
Yeah, anything works for him. Yeah.
Billy Ocean should have had his own cartoon.
You know Elvis doing Bohemian Rhapsody would have been great.
That would have been great.
I'm just a poor boy.
Yeah. Or Stone Cold Crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, they're
Folsom Prison.
Yeah. I apologize that I put this in your head because this will stick with you when you hear songs on the radio. Like,
I think everyone should have their own personal
Elvis
wish
list.
Elvis had done that one list.
Yeah, I agree.
I think that's a really good idea.
It's fun.
said Folsom Prison.
That would be
but
great.
But I just really like that done on the ukulele. When he was learning the ukulele, he decided to learn that song almost first.
Yes.
And there's a really charming thing about hearing him in the other room going, well, I shot a man in Reno. Kinka, chinka, 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 just to watch him die. Chinka, chinka, yeah. chinka, chinka.
It's luau murder.
Yeah,
it's such a clash.
It's happy murder.
Yeah.
It's such a clash of context. It makes me laugh so hard. It's the only way I ever want to hear that song performed again is on the U.
Yeah.
Because it's got this bright, happy little sound, you know. Yeah.
There was a band from Japan called Petty Buka.
I like it
and
already.
They only did, and this was 15 years ago before like ukes kind of got a little hip, and they just did ukulele covers, cute like Pink Lady and Jeff ukulele covers of punk rock songs and like Blondie song, and they do this version of The Tide Is High that's amazing. They do I Want to Be Your Boyfriend.
Yes, to all of this.
It's so they have two albums, highly recommended.
Recommendation accepted.
I'm gonna go home.
And I will pursue
Petty Buka. On the uke.
On the uke. And Dini.
So uke Elvis will be the new thing.
And uke Blondie also.
Yep.
Uke Blondie. I feel like she could
hear you do some uke Misfits maybe.
Okay. Yes.
I want to be sedated.
Oh yeah. Okay. Rock and Roll High School on uke. Yeah.
I want to be sedated. Funny.
I think I had a one.
Beat on the Brat with a baseball bat.
Beat on the Brat would be good.
All right. Okay. Great.
Oh, there is. I do have a Ramones song on my Elvis list.
Which is?
Pet Cemetery.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
I don't want to be buried. It would just be fantastic.
Yes, it would.
Yeah.
It's important.
It needs to happen. The world needs it. That would fix the world.
And you know what? You now have the artist for your soundtrack, Children of the Corn Concert.
Yes. Yes.
Please have it be.
You know, people.
Cemetery cover by an Elvis impersonator.
Perfect. People joke about making deals in Hollywood, but we just made $5 million this very minute. Yeah, just in seconds.
Just for the pilot.
Just for the pilot alone. Yeah. And we own it in perpetuity.
Indeed. Because we know now that we're going to self-produce. And then they can distribute and pay us for our
come
content.
To us. You come to us.
Yeah.
Once we get together, this Elvis impersonator, let Stephen King agree to let us do the Children of the Corn comedy series. We'll probably sell it to us for $1.
I'm sure. Of course.
Yeah.
Because he's just going to want to see them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course. Although he might.
You know what? Let's send it to him in a gift box.
Yeah.
So that when he pulls the ribbon, there's just that anticipation. We can even make it a pop-up book.
Yes.
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 It's crystalline.
Yeah. This is going to work. Yeah.
I was just thinking about Ramones. Rock and Roll High School movie. Whenever it's on, I just watch the whole thing.
You should.
I don't care if it's the last 2 minutes or I just tune in on the credits. It's like Rock and Roll High School is on. I got to watch this all the way through.
The world lost something when we don't have a Paul Bartel in things anymore.
Yeah. Yep.
There's no modern Paul Bartel.
Is Mary Warneroff still around?
She's still around. She's an artist now. She has a lot of paintings and stuff.
Right.
She occasionally will do interviews and they're amazing because she's one of those people who's reached the age where she just doesn't care.
Her and Carrie Fisher.
Yeah.
Gary.
Yeah.
The dog.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Interesting trivia fact for Batman the Animated Series fans. One of the thug hall monitors in that is Lauren Lester, who played Robin in Batman the Animated Series.
And every time
he's on, I go, look, there's Lauren. He's one of the thugs. I think he's eating PJ Soul's goldfish or something like that. Or he's at least in that scene.
Yeah. I mean, you couldn't make a movie like that now. It would be a Nickelodeon series or something.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Or maybe 10 years ago, a Nickelodeon series. Probably not now.
Well, that's the thing. Riff Randall is like not Nickelodeon nor Disney.
Right.
I mean, she's in some way she's even harder edged than Miley Cyrus is now.
Yeah.
Because she just seemed real honest and real
there was like a weird sexual edge as well that you would not be allowed to do with her then.
Well, you got the idea that she was sleeping with the entire band.
Well, yeah.
Like Joey, but the whole everybody.
Yeah. Well, once you have Dee Dee in the shower.
Yeah. The whole bathroom thing where she's getting high and then going to the shower.
Yeah.
And everything.
I guess that wouldn't really fly on Nickelodeon now that I'm thinking about it.
And the giant exploding mice.
Giant and oh my God, why am I forgetting the Opie brother? Oh my God! Why can I not remember?
Oh, yeah.
Holy
he's playing
Christ.
The weasel in the bathroom.
Yes.
Clint Howard has
an office in the bathroom where he sells like drugs and things for people. He's like a fixer.
I saw him and his wife arguing over placemats once.
Oh,
she was so nervous because Ron was coming to their house for Christmas.
You want good placemats?
And she was. They were at the Great Indoor, and she was getting really, really sweet.
Wow.
She wanted the expensive ones, and he was like, "We really don't. He's not going to care."
Yeah.
She's like, "I care.
He's my brother, and I know I'm not spending my ice cream man
it's
money."
It's really not a thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Trivia question. Another trivia question. What famous Disney character did Clint Howard voice?
Oh.
Later. I would guess the badger because he whistles and he's got that giant
going with a goofy
it was
thing
long before that.
I know. Wait, no, it couldn't have been long before Winnie the Pooh's the bad.
Oh, no, no, no. Oh, the gopher.
Yeah, the gopher. Gopher. Yeah, yeah.
No, no. But it was around the same time. Baby Hathi.
What's in Baby Jungle Hathi? Book.
The Colonel Hathi's little son.
The you little know, elephant.
Don't talk in line. Oh, we're yes, drilling. Yes, yes, he yes, was yes. a little elephant in, oh, in the Jungle Book.
Because he was a kid actor.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we're only on 8 o'clock on Saturday. That's why I wanted to just poke around through here. We'll have to do a
part two. Do you actually get through the whole week? Or
oh, yeah, usually. Oh, but sometimes okay. they, well, it's funny. Ooh, like, okay. no, you can I say whatever
too.
You want. Yeah.
I did too.
Yeah.
Earlier.
Oh, no, shit, swearing is perfectly twice. Fine. Yeah.
I'm sorry for saying shit.
It's fine. Podcast. It's fine. I will, I actually go back and replace all non-swears with swears.
Oh,
good.
Yeah, it's like a reverse network television version.
Great,
yeah,
great,
like if people say "darn," I just go back in and put a "damn" in or that kind
so
of. Thing.
So the T in your TV is Tourette's.
Exactly.
That's
exactly.
really nice. Nice.
My favorite edited for TV swear replacement is Repo Man.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
Motherfucker.
Uh-huh.
Melon Farmer. Because they let him, the director, got to pick the swears.
Yeah.
Because he's British and he thought it was ridiculous that they did that. So he goes, he had it in the contract. That's fine. I get to pick the replacement swears. And so their Melon Farmer is fantastic.
And is now appropriated into my colloquial insult dictionary.
As a Melon Farmer.
The first time I saw Animal House.
Farmer? Oh, yeah. That works. Yeah. That works.
Yep.
The first time I saw Animal House on broadcast TV, the scene with the horse and the horse, and it's like John Belushi going, "Holy smoke!" And I'm going, "What?" I don't think those words ever left John Belushi's lips. And it's like they reshot the scene, so they didn't just redub; John Landis got a second take where he just had them not swear.
Because there's two ways to do it. There's that way, and then from the animation world, there's I know that Dave Coulier used to be the replacement voice for Robin Williams and things.
Yeah, that's
they
right.
Would be like for TV versions and that kind of stuff, which is crazy that people would do that. My other favorite one is in Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Uh-huh.
Fucking Dick to Mr. Hand is replaced with Fuzzy Nerd. You fuzzy nerd.
Fuzzy nerd.
Which is not... I would be so much more offended if someone called me that because I'm like, that's what you came up with? Did you see what I did to you in traffic? I cut you right off and you said fuzzy
that's
nerd.
That's all you have?
I was thinking about that. Like, what if you yelled that out the window of somebody? You fuzzy nerd.
Yeah. Obviously in Boston with the rage and traffic situations, to keep myself sane, I would see what innocuous things I could offend someone with as an insult in traffic.
Yeah.
That's just my little game. And my favorite one that always worked was cake taster.
Cake taster.
What are you doing, you cake taster? And people would be like, what? Yeah, that one
Don't
always worked.
Don't you talk to me like
that. That one always worked. That
That's
was a favorite.
Really funny.
Yeah.
Do they still say chucklehead?
Chucklehead's big.
Chucklehead's
yep. Big. That guy's soft. That's a big one.
Okay.
Yep. Chucklehead. Fucking chucklehead.
Fucking chucklehead.
Oh, I have a bit that I've been doing that kind of never works, but it's just for me where I say I'm, you know, sort of ashamed to be from Boston for a lot of the things, but there's one magical element of the Boston accent that I have not heard explored and I have a real pride in, and that's you can take any donut flavor in a Boston accent and it sounds like a euphemism for being drunk. Anyone.
Let's hear it.
Guy is fucking glazed. Whatever, be like, I don't know if you want to get in that car with him. He is chocolate dipped. But like whatever, in every single one, like, I was fucking crulled. And the cops, I am fucking jelly filled.
That girl's maple frosted.
Yeah, whatever it is. He is sprinkled. All of them.
That's really funny.
It's really weird. And I've tried it. People are like, I don't understand this.
But, I get it immediately. We need to animate it.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Every single one. Oh, I love it. Even the weird ones still do. Yeah. Guys, fucking lemon lavender. You know?
It all sounds good.
It really works.
Yeah, it's a fun time.
God,
so what do we get on Monday there?
Or
Sunday? Oh, we didn't get Sunday. Let's jump to Sunday.
We only got to 8 o'clock on Saturday, so we have... we never even talked about Airwolf. We talked about Airwolf, and then Facts of Life was running.
Facts of Life, I love. That was
Golden
85.
Golden Girls in 227.
Yep, No Place Like Home.
And then Love Boat with Emmanuel Lewis.
Yes, the final season of Love Boat. And that's not Love Boat itself. That is the Love Boat fall preview special.
Which was a big deal.
It was an excuse for actors up until the 90s, I think, all wanted to sing at all times. Mm-hmm. So any excuse to sing and to be their character and themselves in a show, they would always do that.
Yes.
So this was,
and then to have their face in a little circle on the thing.
thing with Jane Meadows.
Yes.
You know, yep. Or whoever.
I'm in Love Boat. We don't have any of those all-star cast shows anymore. Even ones that are like Circus of the Stars, which would be a reality show, would probably a liability. And I miss that because it was
I used to love Circus.
It was great.
I remember Brooke Shields walking across broken glass and hot coals. And
yeah.
I was like, that's rad.
Yeah.
The only thing that comes close, I guess, is something like The Voice, where they'll have different celebrities on.
But they're always like an expert. Though. They're above it. They're not in the fray, you know? Yeah. Mm-hmm. You don't have a Dan Haggerty.
What I really liked about Circus of the Stars, which is unfortunately not on our list because it wasn't airing at the time that we took this TV guide, was that they would show, it was a build show.
They'd show the training.
Here's how they're learning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And even though it happened yesterday,
and
here they are doing an easy version with a stunt person although executing
I've weirdly had people on who've
Dance
done
with
it.
The Stars would be close.
Yeah, where they're training. And for the kid actors, at least, they really busted their ass. Like, they were, like, working all day, and then they went to Burbank, and they were doing trapeze all day, and, like, their hands are bleeding for this, you know, half hour or an hour show in 6 months. And I think just, I bet kid actors just wouldn't do it now.
I don't know. You did a pilot where you're teaching magic to
to CeCe DeVille from Poison.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Who wrote the song entitled, I Hate Every Bone in Your Body But Mine.
Yes. When I met him for the first
time. That's going on the Elvis list.
Yep.
Saying, thanks for the memories.
Ah.
Got that from him.
He studied with Ishtok Perlman.
He did. And it was really interesting because he had just been arrested for a DUI. So we incorporated a beer bottle into all the magic he was doing.
Right.
But it was, two things were interesting about it. First of all, he gave an interview where he said, man, I expected to show up, say abracadabra, and pull a dove out my ass. This bitch is a bulldog. She's been working me all day long. And I'm like, and this is why your shit's going to work, my friend.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, he actually had become a magician. He so understood what he was doing. They lit him in a certain way. They gave him a star backdrop. And he said, I can't have that lighting. And they were like, why? And they were shooting us. And they said, well, why? And he said, because you're going to ruin my trick. Just trust me. I can't tell you why, but you need to change it. And I looked at the camera and said, my baby just became a magician. And that was funny. And I said, can I please have that footage? And they said, no.
But that makes perfect sense because those guys, for all the rock and roll thing, the discipline of practicing guitar all day.
Yeah.
It's,
and
you know,
again,
it's
you would
the
think
precision.
He would be, and you'd think he'd be kind of a nitwit or a dingbat. And he sat down and he was like, you know what? He said, because I was saying, do you think that there's any good music now? And he goes, you know who I actually really like is Fallout Boy. And I mean, this is several years
ago.
Yeah. It's like, you know, at least 8 or 9 years.
It was
years
before
ago.
They were a band. It was weird.
Mm-hmm. Right. Like, you knew it was coming.
Putting them together.
I mean, talk about having your finger on the pulse of the
He did
community.
A mentalist act.
Yeah,
you didn't even have to teach him anything.
But it was so interesting hearing him talk about modern music and the appreciation for it.
Yeah.
And he was like, this is why I like them. And, you know, and he was running through a list and he was like, I really think they're going to make it really big. And he said, and they're not alone. I also like this band and that band. And I was like, it was so interesting to just hear him speak and be optimistic about the state of music, because so many of them are like, nope. Sucks.
My day was the best and then everything's terrible.
Back then when we were
Warren broke up, I just couldn't stomach anything.
Cinderella crashed and it was over. You know, so but it was really fun and interesting hearing an artist speak about his optimism.
Yes, and the thing that they know about.
Yeah.
Yeah. In his area of expertise. It's like, no, I actually love, and there was no competition with him. He was like, CeCe DeVille. Yeah. I'm not worried.
Yeah.
Let me tell you who I like. You know, and he was just so comfortable in his own skin and a really rad guy.
See, the interesting thing, and unfortunately, I'll wrap this up, but we have to do this again if you guys are open for this at some point.
We should keep the list.
We'll keep the list. We'll tease the list.
A different night for each podcast.
Yeah, one night. We could.
We didn't really get very far.
Well, I had Greg Proops on and we did a 3-hour one. That was a long one.
But Greg is hilarious.
Yeah.
Good guy to have. Not only have I heard, I don't know personally.
He's super
good. Not only have I heard he's a total stand-up guy, but he is really talented.
Yes. He is incredibly smart.
So funny.
And a huge fan of stuff. He has a film club night, and it's almost like Deville. Like, he'll talk about these movies, and it could be from the art house to whatever, and he just knows everything, so enthusiastic about it, and not in like a, here's some facts I know way. It's just like, here's the thing I thought about, and it's...
And I researched it, and it turns out that the can that they used to light that scene is actually this. And it's like, why did you even...
Right.
Because I love it. And it's like, that's so...
And that's, now that you've said that about that pilot you did, that's what I'm realizing we're missing from media now is that human, it's a humanization of people who work in this business. So you're not seeing the business part, but you're not seeing how hard they work for things.
Well, you just did that profile.
Yeah, I'll send it to you.
Yeah, I'd love to see it.
If you wouldn't mind. But it's they just did a documentary and they show me like cutting a piece of metal and taking it out to Hollywood Boulevard. And it's like, look, this is my job.
Yeah.
This is what I do. And I
you need
know
to practice. And if it's magic or it's musicianship in practice or it's memorizing a whole script, like that actually is work.
Do you remember what it was like for you to tell your first joke? As a kid, you must have been telling jokes all the time.
I would repeat a lot of stuff. I'm a little, I actually always wanted to do magic. I used to take lessons at this place in Medford, Mass with my uncle who, I'll tell you this story later. But my uncle actually ran away from home and joined the circus when he was a kid.
Who was it that was telling me that someone actually ran away from the circus and joined
A home?
Yeah, and joined Charlie Fry.
Charlie Fry's
a juggler in Las Vegas. Yeah. His parents were in the circus, and he didn't want to be in the circus. He ran away from the circus and became a juggler.
He rebelled.
He did.
Wow.
It's like, well, what happens when you run away from the circus? He became a juggler.
There's a show, running away from the circus and joining a home.
Yeah.
So I used to take magical, but the thing that I couldn't do was I'm bad at precision and I'm not great at practice. It's I just can't efficiently practice, and I did martial arts for a long time, same thing. But the things I took from it were misdirection, anticipating people's reactions. So I was a little bit easier when I started doing comedy because I can know how to walk someone down a path to reach an end.
Right.
And so that was helpful. But yeah, you do have to practice a bit. But the people like who do magic or are just amazing actors or have a skill set, I am so impressed by, because they really are working. And the great thing about Circus of the Stars was you got to see that in a way people in America understood. Right. So they may see you acting, that's easy. You're just talking whatever, or you're just doing a trick. The trick does the whole work or whatever it is. But when you see them doing trapeze act for 6 months and their hands are bleeding, your average person goes, I get that they're working hard. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're doing this in everything they do. And we don't have that now. And I think that's why we have these reality shows where everything's kind of easy. They're all and Cinderella stories.
Yeah.
I'll pluck you out of line in obscurity and give you a career instead of they earn something. Because everyone thinks it's like winning the lottery.
Yeah.
But it isn't, because I just told you what those
theories exactly are. Exactly. So it's I don't know if it'll ever swing back there, but it'd be nice if it did.
Well, everybody who's creative, who has a successful or even just a, you know, making a living at their career, doing something creative, they all started when they're young, and they all started honing in on something that they wanted to do, like, oh, okay, hours and hours of music practice.
Right.
Or I remember in college, Mario Cantone, you know, he said that, like, he worked hours and hours in the mirror. He actually had a routine called In the Mirror as a young kid, just in the mirror doing imitations one after another and everything. Well, as a kid, I found out how to ink drawings with a brush. And I would actually cry because I couldn't make the lines very good, but I tried it until I could actually make a figure with a brush like Walt Kelly.
And there's a weird thing like with, and not to complain about millennials, but I see this with younger comics where it's like, if you want to do a thing, you get to do the thing. Because you want to do it. And that's the attitude they have. Mm-hmm. And not, you know, you might, maybe you can't do it. You need to really try hard and you might get there.
Right.
But failing makes you work harder to do it. And
or it should be your cue to stop.
Yes. It either makes you better or it makes you stop. Mm-hmm. And they're not doing that. Yeah. They're just like, well,
failing forward.
Yeah. Or putting these YouTube videos up and go, it's not that I haven't gotten to the skill level yet that people are going to give me things. It's just they haven't seen how great I am. Mm-hmm. And it's weird.
Yeah.
It's weird. And there's not that. Yeah. And I would read so much. I would go to the library and just read all the movie books and all the biographies, and I would read scripts of old vaudeville routines, and just because I loved it. But you absorb all this stuff and watching shows that had references, you know. You're watching the Looney Tunes and you're seeing them do actors of the day impressions, and you're picking that up.
Yeah. I mean, you know, like the other night we were looking around on TV for something to watch, and it's like, no. Want to watch some Python? We break out the Python discs and write them and watch them, and they're just as funny as they were back then as anything now.
Looking up the lyrics to the Military Fairy sketch. Finally,
because they're
all these
timeless
years,
they're not
figuring out what they said.
Not doing, you know, topical humor really, and they're doing stuff that is, they're, first of all, they're inventing a thing, which is always makes it timeless. And maybe I'm just not seeing it, but I don't, there's so much less of it now.
Well, you know, one of the things that we were talking about this the other day is like, you watch a lot of comedy on TV, or you're listening to some comedians, and they're all doing weed jokes, you know?
Yep.
It's like, I'm 22, and I smoke a lot of weed, and I still live at home and everything, and it's all about the weed. And, you know, the thing is that when drug humor was funny, you know, when it was like Cheech and Chong or something like that, or Fireside Theater or something like that, it was sort of it wasn't legal to do it.
Yeah.
And so there was the punishment idea. You're doing something, you're going to get caught.
It was subversive, and they were getting laughed at as well.
Right. But now, because millennials don't know anything other than just themselves, it's like, I wish I could tell them, watch comedians from the 60s. Watch these old guys talking about, it's real fun to drink. I'm having a little drinko. You are Foster Brooks.
Yeah.
You are old, lame guys. It's just like, I'm smoking weed at home. Oh, I'm having a little drinko at the country club. Yep. You are old and stale because all you're talking about is weed, which really isn't all that bad to smoke anymore, but it's not that funny.
It's not that interesting.
It's like a guy talking about, I'm having a scotch. Yeah.
It's airplane food.
Yeah, it is.
Tinder is airplane food.
But that's all they know.
Yes, yeah.
That's all they know.
And I'm seeing there's, you know, a trend with comedians, because all my stuff stories about growing up or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've been told my stuff's alti by like late night bookers, and they're like, people don't know who you are, so they don't want to hear about things you've done, because they really want you to go out and be like, weed or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then they're like, once people know you, then you can talk about yourself. And I'm like, wow. Right. But they do these impersonal one-liner, like Twitter jokes, basically, is what these kids do. And and anyone could do them. You're right. And it's a well-written joke, but it has no personality in it.
Yeah.
And then when they need to do longer sets, they start doing basically bad 80s observational stand-up.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't know that's what they're doing because they've never seen it.
Right.
So they think that them going like, I went to a wedding rehearsal dinner and I was like, hey, I know how to eat. You know, and like that kind of stuff where I'm like, We did this already. No.
The comic book geeks will get this. It's like, if I want to be a comic book artist now, I'm gonna trace Rob Liefeld.
Yeah.
Because he's really cool and dynamic. I've never seen that.
Yeah.
Because you've never seen Neil Adams. You've never seen Jack Kirby. You've never seen Hal Foster, because it just doesn't enter your head to look back.
Pouches versus muscles.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Is there an anatomy book for pouches? I need to know how they move when you have no feet.
Yeah.
If I could figure that out, it would be great.
Well, that's the thing is like, you know, it's like, don't show me how to draw Captain America running into the camera. Show me how to draw, a girl sitting at a table. You know, something, you know, ordinary and everything like that.
Did you see Playing with Fire, that Frank Frazetta documentary?
I think I did. Oh, I might have seen some of it.
It's so good, but I mean, obviously he was a genius and unlike most people, but there's a scene where he's drawing funny animal books because he's just trying to get some money. And they go, we need a rabbit here. And he's never drawn. He goes, I never have drawn a rabbit. Yeah. And they're like, we need one. And they say he just kind of closes his eyes and he thinks, and then he just draws perfectly this rabbit because he's studied what rabbits look like, not drawings of rabbits.
Yeah.
And that's the difference.
And he also knows how to take from what he sees when his eyes are closed and produce that on paper.
Right.
And that comes from practice.
Yes.
And that's, you know, because I think that's one of the hardest things about drawings. You see this image in your head. Now you have to have the skills with your hands to translate what you're thinking.
To show everyone else what you have. And that's music. You know, you have a
music
song. How do you get getting the skills well enough so that you can convey what you're trying to do? Mm-hmm. It's telling a story, telling a joke, doing a magic trick, doing anything.
Yeah.
And that's what they're not developing.
Yes,
they want a shortcut to that.
Yeah.
And it's and their shortcut is reusing things that have been done.
Well, and not only that, but because YouTube provides the medium where anyone can produce and upload that content, they're not required to be special. There's no vetting process.
Right. There's no gatekeeper. Yeah.
Yeah, there's no gate that they must cross with a keeper who says, except you suck, so stay outside until you're
come
back.
Well, they never had to earn anything because they got a prize for showing up.
Yeah.
So it's like, here's my prize, and this is great, and everybody loves me because of this, and now I'm going to go online, and everybody's going to love me because of this, because I'm talking about, basically my life, which is kind of a life from privilege, and everybody loves me, and I'm celebrated and loved, and that's funny.
Yeah. Right? Oh, exactly. Exactly. And the other thing is that, especially like for television and albums and stuff, I've come to the conclusion that people don't appreciate shows as much anymore. They write off like Barney Miller because it's three camera. They don't want to watch it.
Yeah.
And when we were growing up, when you had to watch it, you might watch something and not like it, but then go, I think it might be me. Let me watch it again.
Yeah.
Or let me listen to this album again.
Yeah.
And then those end up being like, those are your favorite albums. Like once it clicks, you're like, oh my God. But they don't have to do that now. They can listen to 30 seconds and move on to the next thing.
There's so much.
Yeah. So they're not holding on to this stuff as much, which is why when I do the show with people who are like born in 1996, they don't have as much of a hold on these shows because they were always there and they didn't wait to see them and they didn't say, I didn't get that first and now I love it. You know, Twin Peaks didn't stick with me or whatever. And I wonder if that's lost completely or if it will come back in a weird way. But it'd be interesting to see.
I remember when I was a kid, I remember the Christmas of 1973, long before I was born. That was like a Christmas I spent on the bus because I was 13, 14. And I couldn't drive anywhere. And I lived in Orinda, and we have a great movie theater there now, but at that time it was the second run house. So if I wanted to see the new movies, I'd take BART into the city and then get on a bus.
Yeah.
And there were two movies I wanted to see that you had to see. One was Woody Allen's Sleeper.
Yep.
And it rained a lot that year, and I had to get early, take BART in, pouring rain, wait outside in a line to get in to see Sleeper because that was the weekend it was opening. I had to see it, and it was only at the theater. And I was drenched in the rain and was soaking wet, and I saw Sleeper and loved it. God, funny. And then the next day, there was one theater showing Disney movies, and it was Disney's Robin Hood. It was the same thing, only I had to go like twice as far because that was playing out in Daly City.
Yeah.
At the one place, because Disney movies were suck ass at that time. Nobody wanted to see Disney movies, like Herbie the Love Bug. Yeah, we'll show it out.
The Gnome Mobile.
Yeah, exactly. So I got on BART. I went on one bus as far as I could. Then I got on another bus. Then I walked like half a mile across a parking lot, pouring rain. I'm getting there and watch Robin Hood, going like, it's a new Disney cartoon. I'm watching it. Sucks pretty bad, but some of the stuff is kind of bad.
You're picking out things you like so you can justify the means you had to go there to get.
The cat and the snake are really fun. The lion and the snake are really funny. Everything else in the movies kind of sucks. And look, there's half the animation reused.
Okay. Yeah. But you're learning that because you're kind of tuning out from the story because it's not great, but you're learning about how animation works and structure because you're paying attention to different things because you have to sit there for the whole time.
That's how you
and also, before that, you know, like months before that, I was writing to an animator at Disney Studio. I was sort of an older mentor, pen pal, a guy named Ward Kimball, who was one of Disney's nine old men. And I said, are they going to make new cartoons? He goes, well, they're making this one called Robin Hood. I'm not involved in it, but it's going to be kind of funny.
Yeah.
And so I said, I'm going to go see that. So I went there, and it's like, okay, it became kind of a big event. Like going to see Sleeper was sort of like, this is a big deal. I really want to see this movie.
But that's how you become an expert.
You need to sort of feel you earned it.
And so entertainment was like a big deal. You know, like when I found something that I really loved, like later that year, or you know, early the next year, Cheech and Chong was at a Monterey Peninsula College, and it's like, I get a ride in.
Yeah.
Got to see Cheech and Chong because I, you know, we have one album. I was going to a boarding school. We all passed it around.
Yeah. It's a sense of urgency, too.
Okay. I'll never see them again.
And scarcity.
Yeah.
And scarcity makes it special, and it makes you want to consume it over and over and really understand.
Yeah.
It.
And you have that connection. And that, I mean, I'd take two buses and a train to rent a Racerhead.
Right.
There you go.
There you go. Yeah. Well, thank you guys so much for doing this.
Thanks
we'll have to do it again. And it was great to talk to you guys, and I really appreciate it.
Likewise. Thank you. Thanks. And we got through Sunday at 8:00.
That's true. So we have a whole five more days left.
Six.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That was a lot. Saturday at 8:00.
You know this is the first cliffhanger episode I'll have.
Oh. Oh. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. There you have it. As I told you, very fascinating. Didn't get that far into the week, but we've kept the copy of their choices under lock and key so we can go back to it at some point. Stay tuned to the same TV Guidance Counselor channel at the same TV Guidance Counselor time at an undetermined date where we will do this part two and get through the rest of the week. But hopefully you'll be able to sleep in anticipation. It'll happen. How great are they? They're great. Love talking to them. I will put up information on tvguidancecounselor.com for all their social media stuff. I'll put a link to that little documentary Misty was talking about from Vice, which is really, really great. You'll want to check out all the things they do if you're not already a fan. And as for this show, we have a new episode every single Wednesday, so be sure to be back here next week. We also have episodes on other days, sometimes just as a surprise, so be sure to subscribe on iTunes so you don't miss any of those episodes. If you have any questions about the show or really anything, I will do my best to answer. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at kenatiknread.com. You can also tweet to us at TV Guidance. You can sign up for our mailing list at tvguidancecounselor.com, or you can go on Facebook and like our page. Just search TV Guidance Counselor, or you can just see us next week when we have a new episode. I don't even have to know you're listening, but it'd be nice if you let me know. So we'll see you again next time on TV Guidance Counselor.
Put your robe on you when you walk around the house, Ken.
I don't know anything about Spider-Man, so I need you guys to tell me because people don't know.
Hee Haw salutes my hometown, Orinda, California, population 14,000. Salute.
Janet Jackson's boob in a hot tub in White Castle. We also had pizza. I saw him and his wife arguing over placemats once. I remember Brooke Shields walking across broken glass and hot coals. And I was like, that's rad.